So now we are going to talk about fiber. We just got done looking at starch and glycogen, which glucose is the building block. Glucose is also the building block for fibers. Cellulose fiber, which is an insoluble fiber, you can see here, glucose is the sole building block. It also is very linear, so it can compact together and it doesn't let a lot of water in, which is why it's insoluble. But you can see here, comparing the bonds between the glucose molecules of glycogen and starch, the bonds look different here in cellulose. And because of the way these glucose molecules are bonded together, we are not able to break these bonds in the digestive tract with enzymes. And so these fibers will pass through the digestive system undigested, where they will make their way to the colon. So that's one difference with fiber compared to starch and glycogen. Even though glucose is the building block for all these three polysaccharides, structurally, they are a little bit different. So the two types of fibers are soluble and insoluble. And the different fibers fall into these different categories based on, as you'd guess here, their structure and their solubility to water. I will say, as more research goes on with fibers, we're learning that, not oftentimes can you place a fiber in these two specific categories, and sometimes there is some crossover between these two categories. So you might have an insoluble fiber that actually does attract some water and is a little bit soluble in water. So first here we'll look at the insoluble fibers. One example of that is cellulose. There are other types of insoluble fibers as well, like hemicellulose, which would be a more branched fiber and actually would be a little bit more soluble in water compared to cellulose. But the purpose of the insoluble fibers is to provide structure to the plants, to the stems, to the seeds. And so you will find not just insoluble, but all types of fibers in all whole plant foods because they are serving a purpose for the plant, in this case, providing structure to the plant. Like we just discussed earlier, the building block is primarily glucose, although there can be some other sugars and different types of insoluble fibers, but in cellulose, it would be glucose. It is very linear. However, you can see the bonds here are drawn a little bit differently. So with starch, we drew a straight line, and we're drawing a different bond here just to show that that bond is different, and we don't have the enzymes to break the bond between those sugars and actually absorb this glucose. So we don't absorb this glucose and get energy from insoluble fiber. Does anything happen to cellulose so something can get absorbed? Well, I just discussed that there's no enzymatic digestion, so typically no, but there may be some bacterial fermentation. Typically, the soluble fibers are more fermentable, but again, as we learn more about fibers, we're learning that there could be some bacterial fermentation with the insoluble fibers as well, and I'll talk more about that with the soluble fibers. The main reason that insoluble fibers are good for us is to promote intestinal health and to decrease constipation. These are fibers that add bulk to the feces. They also speed up transit time. They really make just for a bulkier, softer stool, which aids in elimination. It also keeps the muscles in the digestive tract toned and strong, working hard to push this bulkier stool along. The soluble fibers, again, there's lots of different types of soluble fibers. These fibers tend to be very water soluble because they're more branched. So the structure is going to be a little bit different. They're in most whole plant foods. The examples here are oats and dried beans, many fruits, and the building blocks for these types of fibers can be glucose, but other types of sugars as well. And these are the fibers that typically bacteria are able to break down. In that fermentation process, when bacteria are using these sugars for their own energy needs, a fat-like substance called butyrate is created. And this is actually a substance that intestinal cells can use as an energy source, and it actually can get absorbed into the bloodstream and travel to the liver, where it will have some physiological benefits as well. So let's talk about those. Why is it good for us to eat foods with soluble fiber? Well, one of the main benefits that soluble fiber is marketed towards health is heart health. It helps decrease blood cholesterol levels. It can do this a couple different ways. Soluble fiber actually binds bile, which contains cholesterol, and then it removes it from the body. It actually carries cholesterol out of the body. That molecule butyrate I just mentioned, it's thought that fat-like substance travels to the liver and somehow decreases cholesterol synthesis. So a couple different ways there that cholesterol levels may be improved with soluble fiber. These soluble fibers, they are viscous, which means they can form like a gel, kind of like a thick liquid in your stomach. So this can help slow down enzyme activity and nutrient absorption, specifically glucose absorption, which can be really beneficial for someone with diabetes who doesn't want high blood glucose levels. It can also help us feel fuller longer, so may help us with weight loss and weight maintenance. And you'll see these soluble fibers like pectins and gums listed in ingredient lists. Look at a salad dressing or look at a box of pudding, and you'll see these added to foods in order to thicken food, just like they form thick fluids in our stomach. So, of course, a common theme for this course is increasing your whole food, specifically plant food intake. These are going to be the best ways to get a high fiber diet: whole fruits, whole vegetables, whole grains, beans, nuts, and seeds are great examples. When you start removing parts of the food, then you're gonna lose nutrients and oftentimes fiber. So, for example, when we go from a fresh orange to orange juice, you can see here is the orange, here's the calories, 21 grams of carbohydrate, 4 grams of fiber. When you juice that juice, and not peeling it and throwing it in a blender, but actually juicing it where all the structure, the fiber, is left behind, you can see you concentrate the calories and the sugars a little bit more. And then look at that, less than 1 gram of fiber. All that fiber, the structure, is left behind when juicing. So you gotta eat the whole plant food in order to get the fiber and the other benefits that come along with it, the other vitamins, minerals, phytochemicals that are packaged in these foods as well.